Okay, our next topic is numerical integration. Numerical, meaning to say we look at a lot of numbers, which I actually don't like them. But anyway, we have to explain these two types of numerical integration, trapezoidal rule and Simpson's rule. So I'll walk you through how each one works. Okay, if we have time, maybe we can talk about approximation for the error. If not, we can do it next time.
Yes.
Okay? So when do we actually have to use numerical integration? Well, sometimes maybe you don't, you know, this all arises from having to evaluate the definite integral of f of x dx, right?
Yes.
From a to b, okay? Well, it's nice if you can easily find the f, right? The antiderivative f, okay? Then just evaluate that from
a to b.
But what if we have weird functions? We don't care about the limits of integration right now, okay?
Yes.
So supposing we want to integrate from a to b, let's say a function like square root of x sine x.
Yes.
That's pretty scary, right?
Yes.
Okay? So we don't know how to do that.
Exactly.
Or what if we have something like square root of 1 plus x to the 4th dx, or 1 plus, okay?
Yes.
So you get the idea?
Okay? Exactly.
So these are some problems that you may encounter. What we say here is that there is no elementary function, really, big F, that gives you the antiderivative, okay?
Yes.
Of these, okay, integrals. Okay, so we look at the trapezoidal rule. Well, so far we have been using what when we are approximating the definite integral? What geometric shape have we been using?
Trapezoid.
Have we been using trapezoids?
No.
In my discussion of the Riemann sum?
No, not yet. That was rectangle.
Rectangle.
Yes.
Right? Okay. So far in my discussion, whenever I have something like this, what I did was to draw rectangles.
Yes.
Right? Okay, and kind of make my approximation based on rectangles. Now the title is trapezoidal rule, so the clue is what? Now what kind of geometric shape will we see?
We're going to use trapezoid.
We're going to use trapezoids. Okay. So the story really is, let's say we have a function, and again the function can go down. Okay,
yes.
Below the x-axis, okay? And again, we're interested, let's say, in the definite integral from a to b, okay?
Yes.
Of this function, y equals f of x.
Yes.
Now, how did the trapezoids come about? Well, what we're going to do is, because we don't know how to find the elementary function corresponding to the f, right?
Yes.
We don't know how to get the big f, for instance. What we are going to do is we are going to look, again, the idea is to subdivide this, okay?
Yes.
Into subintervals. Let's see what color. Okay, so this is your x of 0. Let's say this is your x1.
Yes.
And also, by the way, for trapezoidal rule, we are just going to limit ourselves to what we call a regular partition. Again, what's the meaning of a regular partition?
Same length.
Same length, okay? Otherwise, it will be too crazy. Okay?
Yes.
So we will just have a regular partition, so the delta x, which we will call h in this case,
yes,
will be all the same length. So if we use n subintervals, the length will be what? Do you remember how to calculate
delta x divided by b minus a over n.
Okay, the right end point, right, minus the left end point divided by the number of subintervals,
yes,
you're interested in. Okay, so we'll keep it simple, just regular subintervals. Okay, so how did that come about, the trapezoidal rule? So what happens is, if you look at the first subinterval, for instance, okay?
Yes.
What this is doing is, instead of using the actual curve, we are going to approximate that curve by a line, okay?
Yes.
A linear function, okay? So we are going to use a linear function to approximate that curve. And you can see now the story is, of course, as you get closer, that line is almost like the curve,
yes,
right? And so you actually get this, and if you see this, I don't know if this looks like a trapezoid to you. In the beginning, we were just either using the minimum or the maximum and drawing a rectangle, right?
Yes.
Now we actually allow it to slant.
Yes.
Right?
That's right.
So therefore, you have a trapezoid. So let's go to this one. So x1 to x2, instead of using this curve, we are going to use the linear. Approximation. That line.
Yes.
Get it?
Yes.
And now you see again your trapezoid.
Yes.
Make sense?
That's right.
All right. So, I don't want to mess up the picture, but yeah, you'll have so many trapezoids here. Okay. So now we are going to, instead of looking at the area of a rectangle, we want to find the area of a trapezoid.
Trapezoid.
Right?
Yes.
So, do you remember how to find the area of a trapezoid.
We're going to add the top base and bottom base and then divide by.
Maybe I should exaggerate this. Could you see this, that this is really like that, right?
Yes.
Okay. You said you're going to add the top base, which is this, right?
Yes.
The top base.
Yes.
We're going to add this base and this base, right?
Yes. Multiply by half of the height.
So let's see, what's the area of a trapezoid? Like this, right?
Yes.
It's base one, base two, and then you need a height, right?
Yes.
So that's going to be half what?
B1 plus B2.
B1 plus B2 times
H.
The height.
Yes.
Right? Okay. So if we look at the first one, for instance, okay, what will be the area of this? It's going to be what? This height, right?
Yes.
Now what is this? This base. This base corresponds to what? Let's label these points. This point is x sub 0, corresponding y is, of course, f of x sub 0. Get
yes.
that?
Yes.
This next point is x sub 1, corresponding y is f of x sub 1.
Yes.
Correct?
That's right.
Okay, why do I need those? Well, because here this is f of x0, right?
Yes.
And this one is f of x1, correct?
Yes.
Okay, so therefore I need, this is my first base, that's the next one,
yes.
right? So for the first one, I'll have half f of x sub 0, right?
Yes.
Plus f of x sub 1, follow?
Yes.
And then multiply that by the h, correct?
Yes.
Okay, multiply by the h. For the next one, what do I get? This is my next trapezoid,
yes.
right? So again, it's the same story. I get what? Half? Of what?
F of
this
x1.
F of x1.
Plus f of
now
x2.
Now the next one is this, which is f of x2.
X2.
You get it?
Yes.
Okay? Plus f of x2.
Times h.
Times h. Do you see the story?
Yes.
And so on and so forth. So now if I get this, let's see, I'm in trouble here. This is my trapezoid here, right?
Yes.
Correct? Because I'm going to... No, is that my trapezoid? No, I'm sorry, wrong. This is my F, this is my approximation. Yeah, this is ugly. Should I rewind that? No, maybe erase that. Don't show that. I'll edit it out.
Okay.
So maybe I'll go here.
Yes.
Right? Because, so this is X of K minus 1. Okay, ready?
Yes.
So it will just keep repeating, okay? I don't want to draw my trapezoid here, but it's, again, the next one will be what? Just to continue, it will be half f of x2, right?
Yes.
Plus f of x3
times h.
Etc., and then here you'll have something like that again, right? Anyway, do you see the story already?
Yes.
So what is the story? Now let's look at the last one. Let's say this is the last one, which is this is my x sub n, right?
Yes.
Let's look at the x sub n minus
n 1. N minus 1.
Again, let's do the trapezoid. So we have this. Okay. So if we continue the story, notice that here f of x1 is repeated, right?
Yes.
F of x2 is repeated. F of x3 will be repeated.
Yes.
Correct? Okay. And so on and so forth. Now, where will the repetition stop?
F of xn.
F of xn will not be repeated anymore, right?
Yes.
Okay, so if we look at the last one, so it will be a half f of x of n minus 1. Right?
Yes.
Plus
f of x sub n
times h. Okay?
Yes.
Now this f of x sub n will not be repeated anymore, but this f of x sub n minus 1 will be repeated or was stated here, right?
Yes.
Before this. You see that?
Yes.
Okay? So that is your trapezoidal, that's what we get, okay? We sum this up. Now we can just make this look a little bit nicer. So if we want to make this look nicer, how can we write it nicer? First of all, I see one halves all over the place, right?
Yes.
So what can I do with the half?
If you can factor this out.
I can factor out the half, right?
Yes.
In fact, I can take out the half h.
H.
Correct?
Yes.
Okay. And then the first one will be what? f of x sub 0, 1 time, no repetition,
yes,
right?
Yes.
And then the next one is f of x 1, but it's what?
Again repeated.
Multiplied by 2, right?
2.
2 f of x sub 1.
Yes.
Okay? And then f of x sub 3 will also be multiplied by 2, and so on and so forth, right?
Yes.
Everybody in the middle will be multiplied by 2.
By 2.
To where? F of x sub
n.
N minus 1. And then the last one, f of x sub n, will just be?
Just 1.
Itself.
Yes.
1. Okay?
Yes.
Now this is, some books use T. Okay? Notation is T.
T.
To denote the sum.
Yes.
Alright? And we know that this sum is really just what? This is an approximation to the definite integral a to b of f of x
dx.
Okay, so
yes.
That's how you use your trapezoidal rule.
Yes.
Okay, ready for an example?
Example, okay. Okay,
okay, let's just give a simple example of the use of the trapezoidal rule. Of course, we know the answer for this, right? We can get the actual answer for this. But
yes.
Just to illustrate how trapezoidal rule works, so we want the integral from 1 to 2 of x squared dx. So x squared, we all know how to graph that, hopefully, right?
It's a parabola.
The graph is a parabola. Okay, so from 1 to 2, x is 0, 1, 2 is 4, right?
Yes.
So we have roughly something like this, okay? And we're just interested in this interval from 1 to 2. You guys should blow it up. So this is your f of x equals x squared.
Yes.
Okay? And we want to use n equals 4. That means to say we have to subdivide the interval into how many pieces? 4, right?
4 pieces.
Okay? So we have 4 pieces. Okay, so we have this. So if this is the first one is 1, let me blow that up here. Okay? So you have 1 to 4. No, 1 to 2, right? Right?
One yes.
To
two. 1 to 2.
So
four.
You divide into 4 pieces.
Four
so
pieces.
This next piece will be what? So what will be the length of the subinterval if we find our h?
2 minus 1 divided by 4.
2 minus 1 over 4, which is 1
fourth. 1 fourth.
Right? That's
yes.
What you should get first.
Yes.
So what you do is you just keep adding
1 fourth
to the previous, right?
Yes.
So this will be 1 and 1 fourth or 5 fourths.
5 over 4.
Right?
6
plus
over 4.
Plus 1 fourth is 6 fourths or 3 halves if you wish, right?
Yes.
Plus 1 fourth is
7
fourths. And then plus another fourth you get your
2.
Okay? Actually for this kind of problem, for these numerical integration problems, I recommend that you draw a chart. Okay?
Yes.
You can put all your x's here. So our x's start from 1, then you have 5 fourths, 6 fourths, 7 fourths, and 2. Okay?
Yes.
Some books actually include this column, they call it K, corresponding to the number of subintervals, right? So you
yes.
have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay?
Yes.
Alright, so you may put that. The important pieces are x and what? F of x.
F of x.
Right? So you want to get the value of f of x. So all you do here is substitute 1 there, right?
Yes.
So it's numerical. That's why it's numerical integration. We're really just dealing with numbers.
Numbers.
Okay? So then you have, what am I doing? F of 1 is 1, right?
One. Yes.
F of 5 fourths is 25 over 16.
16.
Right? F of 6 fourths, that's F of 3 halves, right? Is
yes.
what? 9?
9 over 4.
Or maybe, if you want to keep the 16, there's an advantage to keeping the 16, right?
Yes.
There's an advantage.
Yes.
If you like to do fractions, right?
Yes.
The advantage is you can easily add because the denominators are the same.
It's
okay.
The same.
7 fourths, you have 49.
49 over 16.
And then you have, 2 is what?
4.
Right?
Yes.
Okay. So that's what you have there. Now, this column, so Kausi calls it M, I guess, for a multiplier. That's the constant that you see being multiplied, okay?
Yes.
So for the first one, look at the formula. It's what? The first answer, does it get multiplied by 2? Reza?
Yes.
Does it?
The first, no.
The first one by 2? No, right?
No.
So this is 1,
one.
For the first one.
Yes.
The second, the third, and the fourth all get what?
Multiplied by 2.
They all get multiplied by 2. And we explained why, right?
Yes.
Using those trapezoids that like are adjacent to each other.
Yes.
And the last one, what is the multiplier?
A 1.
It's just 1. Okay, So put that on your chart, and then hopefully your life will be easy doing that, easier.
Yes.
Do it like that. So then what's the next thing that we want to do? We want to multiply this M by the f of x, right? We want
yes.
to multiply these two columns. So 1 times 1 is 1, right?
Yes.
2 times 25 is 50 over 16, okay?
Yes.
2 times 36 is 72 over 16. Again, we're just keeping the 16 if you don't have a calculator like I don't have now. Okay, so, and then you have 98 over 16.
Yes.
And then this is 4. Okay?
Yes.
And what do you do with these?
We actually add them up.
We add them up, right? So we take the summation of these, okay? We add them up.
Yes.
And this is what I was saying. You can add these up longhand, okay? Sorry, I'm behind the times. So you have 10, 6 plus 7, 13 plus 9, 22. Did I do it right?
200, okay.
All right, assuming yes. that's correct. 220 over 16. So you have 220 over 16. 1 plus 4 is 5. So you have 5 and 220 over 16, which of course you have to do. You have to do the arithmetic here.
Yes.
So on and so forth.
Yes.
Now, because these are numerical calculations, you actually might decide, I usually like fractions, but in this case, I think it's better to just use decimals, because most students, they have your calculators anyway,
yes,
right?
Yes, exactly.
So instead of leaving your answer like this, and in fact, I did that before coming here, I said, well, this is going to be 3.125, this is 4.5, this is 6.125, okay? I added them up and I got 18.75. Hope that's correct, right?
Yes.
Okay. So that's the sum, okay? But what does the trapezoidal rule say? What do you have to do with this sum? Let's go back to this formula. Do I need to rewrite this or you're okay?
No, that's fine.
We add them up, right?
Yes.
And after adding up those numbers, what do you have to do?
Multiply
you
by.
You have to multiply by 1/2 h, or you can also write 1/2 h as h
over, h over 2.
Okay? So you multiply by 1/2 h. Are you okay?
Yes.
H is 1/4, right? So therefore, if you get 1/2 h, what's 1/2 of a 4th?
It's 1 over 8.
It's 1/8, right? So this sum, you multiply by 1/8. Okay, so multiply by 1/8, all right?
Yes.
And therefore you can say that the integral from 1 to 2 of x squared dx is approximately what? 1/8?
1/8 times.
Times 18.75. Did I do that? I got 2.34, does that sound right? 34375. Okay?
Yes.
So that's how you do your trapezoidal rule. Again, it's a simple example. If you want to see how close your approximation is, again, of course, because that's why I chose this easy one, we can actually get the exact answer for this, right?
Yes.
We can integrate this x cubed over 3, right?
Yes.
Okay? Evaluate it from 1 to 2, and so you get what? 2 cubed. Over 3.
8 over 3 minus 1 over 3.
So that's 8 thirds.
7 over 3.
1 third, which is 7 thirds. And if you do 7 thirds as a decimal,
2 and 1 third.
2, 6. It's about 2.3.
2.3.
Something, right? Okay.
Yes.
And you can keep going and see how close that is.
Yes.
To that one. Okay?
Yes.